The topic is processing and preservation. And today, to make it more interactive in this part, we have invited Dr. Saroj Mahajan, Principal Bhaskaracharya College. This is one of the college which is running the diploma program in fruit and vegetable very successfully. And our subject expert is Dr. Charanjit Kaur on processing and preservation. She is senior scientist in IRI. Now I will request Dr. Charanjit Kaur to cover the complete block consisting of five units, minimal processing, processing by heat application, drying and dehydration, freezing and chemical additives. So all these five units, Dr. Charanjit Kaur will be dealing in detail in an interactive mode with Dr. Saroj Mahajan. Dr. Charanjit Kaur, please.
Now, in this module, we have, as Dr. Saluja has said, that we have five important processing methods of processing being discussed: minimal processing and heat application, use of freezing and use of drying and dehydration, and then use of chemical additives. The first chapter is focused upon minimal processing.
In this, may I ask you a question? What is minimal processing, the so-called MP? What are the factors that have favored this processing trend, and what are its advantages?
Yeah, this minimal processing, or if you read the chapter, you will also find an alternative term in this, that is, it is also said to be light processing. This is a new kind of processing which is an emerging technology. Not very common in India, but it's emerging in cities. Now, this basically refers to invisible processing, a processing which you may not see as such. But if you see, you know, this may refer to procedures such as washing, trimming, slicing, or chopping of the fruits or vegetables that does not affect the freshness of the product. So if you see, suppose if you have a shredded cabbage, now cabbage is shredded, all the initial unit operations like cutting and washing and chopping, they have been completed, and there is only slight processing or light processing or even minimal processing is there. That is why it is said to be a minimal processing. Now there are a number of factors, you know, which have led to this emergence of this technology. Now if you see in cities, especially in cities, if you see that we have more of eating out habits. Now kids, you know, they want to eat lot of fast foods. We have also more of working women in the population. So naturally, when you have more working women in the population, woman doesn't have time for cooking. She always wants convenience. And this has been elaborated in the beginning of the chapter. There is a need for the consumer in terms of convenience. We want procedures or processing in such a manner which can help in our day-to-day cooking. And apart from that, because women are working, now we have dual incomes in the family, they also have a need for quality. So focused on the need for convenience and focusing on the need for the quality, there is an emerging new trend towards the minimally processed kind of foods. Now, the major advantages, especially if you see the conditions in India, is basically they are now only can be used only for the catering industry, because catering industry can use shredded cabbage for number of products. They can use shredded sliced onions for number of products. Like if you see big brands like pizzas and all, they can use these shredded and different kinds of vegetables. So the major advantage they offer is in terms of convenience, I've already said, and you have a supply of ready to eat items which is excellent in uniformity and quality over an extended period of time. The shelf life is there for about 5 to 10 days depending upon the product. So always remember that these products have a very limited shelf life.
These minimally processed products, they are perishable. Why is it so?
Yeah, as we have already talked, you know, in terms of, in case of the fresh fruits and vegetables, minimally processed products are also perishable, because the moment we cut them, the moment we cut a tissue or we cut a vegetable, it accelerates the biochemical changes. The ethylene we have talked about respiration rates. The moment you cut a fruit and vegetable, the respiration rate goes higher, the ethylene gas is produced, and then enzymes are also liberated, and this, you know, increases the risk for microbial infections. That is why these products become highly perishable. That is why, you know, they also have a limited shelf life.
Now the question is, if it is so, how to reduce these losses?
Yeah, this is very important, because we have to maintain an adequate shelf life for about a week or about, say, 21 days, depending upon the kind of product. And then we have discussed about the major processing methods which we can use for extending shelf life of these products. But always remember that we will not follow any harsh method of processing in these kinds of products. We will not use any major heat treatment or drying or even freezing. Only what we will do is use of mild preservatives, anti-browning agents. We will follow good manufacturing practices, because this is the crux of minimally processed foods, maintaining hygienic conditions. Because if you maintain hygiene, you can eliminate microorganisms by itself. And then packaging is also a kind of a preservation factor. And then maintaining low temperature is very important for the retail outlet shelf life of these processed products.
What are the main basic unit operations?
And
if you could elaborate on the good manufacturing processes, the so-called GMPs.
Yeah, GMPs. Always remember that for minimal processing, four important things: quality raw material, light processing, and a combination of good manufacturing practices and low temperature storage. You know, they are very important to maintain shelf life. Some of the unit operations which we see in this case is, if you see, these are general operations which mostly are focused upon cleaning and washing. But the only difference here you will find in case of these products is that we use two washing. One is the first washing, which we do before cutting, and then is the second washing which we do after cutting. So this is different from the other kinds of processing, in which we have two washings, one before and one after. And since we are washing it second time after we are cutting, it is important to remove the moisture content. That is why what we do, we use spin drying for removing the incipient moisture. And then finally, by using some dripping treatments, mild anti-browning agents, using in very low doses, and then effective packaging depending upon the kind of product we have. And then finally, the last is storage at low temperature. So if we can summarize the key requirements for maintaining quality in minimal processing: quality raw material, then washing, second washing. We have all emphasized the need for second washing. And after second washing, then gentle spin drying. And again, as the question was asked, you know, chlorine. So good quality water, and which may have chlorine, because chlorine can be used as a disinfectant. Then right kind of packaging material, maybe HDP, high density polyethylene or low density polyethylene. And then very important, low temperature during distribution and during retailing. These are very important key requirements for maintaining quality in minimally processed products.
Heat processing, second chapter. In this, Dr. Saab, I would like to ask you the main objectives of heat processing. What are they?
Yeah, we use different kinds of heat processing. You know, there are different kinds of terms if you read the chapter: blanching, pasteurization, and sterilization. So the basic purpose of heat processing is to use these to give blanching or to give pasteurization or to sterilize foods. But the main purpose, the objective, is to increase the shelf life, and this we can do by minimizing or by removing or eliminating microorganisms, especially those microorganisms which are important for public health concern, which can cause food poisoning. So that is why we say they can minimize foodborne diseases. Always remember, pasteurization kills only the major kinds of microorganisms which are of public health concern, but still there may be some microorganisms which may be left behind. That is why, you know, pasteurization is always used in conjunction with low temperature. After pasteurization, if you want to maintain shelf life, you also have to put them under low temperature. Now, depending upon the kind of product which you have, depending upon the kind of method, kind of product, it may be good, whether you are sterilization. Say, sterilization, in fact, we do not sterilization. In fact, in case of fruits and vegetables, we do not use sterilization. We use commercial sterilization. Sterilization is normally used for containers or for cans, because very high heat treatment is used. So depending upon the kind of product which you have, it may be pasteurization or it may be sterilization. If it is a canned product, then sterilization may be a good option.
What are the desirable changes caused by heat? And at the same time, if you could throw some light on the undesirable changes also.
So the desirable, now if you see the most desirable change, which in fact is a major objective of heat processing, is to eliminate microorganisms. And specifically, always remember to eliminate pathogenic microorganisms which are of human health concern. And apart from this, destruction of enzymes, because fruits and vegetables have enzymes, and so enzymes have to be removed or have to be inactivated. This is taken care by blanching. And then it also affects the color, it also affects the flavor and texture. And apart from this, it also helps to improve the digestibility of certain kinds of fruits. You should know that there are basically, three kind of heat treatments. You have learnt about pasteurization is one, and there is second is the blanching, and then is sterilization. Now, if you see, I've given here, pasteurization is heating at a temperature less than 100 degrees C. Then blanching is in between this, 90 to 100 degrees C. Sterilization is a very high heat treatment, say even higher than 100 degrees C. Normally, we do not use the word sterilization in case of processing, because sterilization is a very high heat treatment, and we cannot afford to lose color and texture, because if you give very high heat, it can seriously affect the color and the flavor. So we use commercial sterilization as the right term in case of processed products. But pasteurization and blanching terms are commonly used. Now let's see. Now just summarize what key points you should always remember when you learn about pasteurization. It's a low order heat treatment, destroys pathogenic microorganisms. I've been emphasizing on pathogenic microorganism. You must have come across the term Clostridium botulinum. So Clostridium botulinum is one of the pathogenic microorganisms, and by pasteurization we are trying to eliminate this. Then this is basically a heat treatment which is used for milk. You see how milk is boiled at home, then maybe also used for fruit juices. Then the products contain many living microorganisms which are capable of growth, thus limiting shelf life. That is why when we pasteurize, this has to be coupled with some low temperature storage. Otherwise, you will have a very less shelf life. Then there was a question regarding blanching. Blanching, always remember that blanching is a heat treatment which is given at 90 to 100 degrees C. And this is basically used as a pre-treatment before drying and before freezing. If you want to freeze, you have to inactivate enzymes. If you want to dry your product, you have to give a blanching treatment. It's a very simple treatment. What you do is you immerse your vegetables, or normally it is used for vegetables. Sometimes it may be even used for fruits, but normally for vegetables. You immerse your vegetables or commodity into boiling water, and the time, or again depends upon the commodity which you may have. after immersing for a fixed period of time, you remove them and put them under cold water. So always remember, it's not only putting them in hot water, but also cooling them after that. So putting them in boiling water and then cooling them. Both are important in blanching. Let us see what are the purposes of this blanching treatment. I've already emphasized the major purposes to inactivate enzymes. And apart from this, you know, they also, because you are also putting them in water, so you are also doing a washing kind of treatment. So certain surface microorganisms are also removed in this case. And air is also removed from the tissues. And this, so when air is removed, it makes the product more compact. Especially this is used, this kind of effect you can see in dehydrated products. And because enzymes are removed, you can maintain the color, flavor and texture. Now, I think I'll come to another important heat treatment, which is sterilization. Now, students should make it very absolutely, it should be clear in their minds what is the difference between blanching, pasteurization and sterilization. Now, sterilization is a very harsh kind of a heat treatment. I've already said this. So it is taken at a very high temperature, say even more than 100 degrees C, say about 121 degrees C for about 15 minutes or more. That is why we do not use sterilization when we process foods. This may be more commonly used to sterilize containers like cans. If you see, cans have to be, any of your packaging material which is used for packaging has to be sterilized. So sterilization may be used for sterilization of containers or cans. Now, what is the alternative for sterilization in processed food? We normally try to use commercial sterilization. So we always remember, students should never confuse with sterilization and commercial sterilization. Fruits and vegetables cannot be given a very high heat treatment because it can affect the color and flavor and texture. You may end up with a very sloppy kind of a tissue. Always remember that we use commercial sterilization because in this to destruct the pathogenic and toxin microorganisms. And because certain microorganisms are remaining, we cannot remove them. But so that they are not able to multiply, we create conditions so that they do not multiply. And this can be done by using hermetic sealing or by maintaining very low pH conditions. Because it is not possible to eliminate all microorganisms. We only have to eliminate the pathogenic forms. Certain microorganisms may be there, but we have to maintain those conditions wherein these microorganisms are not able to grow and cause any spoilage. And this we do by maintaining low pH conditions or by hermetic sealing, as we do in case of canning. So always remember these two points when you talk about commercial sterilization.
Could we now go to the next chapter, freezing?
Before that, you know, I think I would like to make a very important point here. Students should also remember that the different classification which has been given in the chapters, according to different pH. Because if the pH of the food is very low, if you have a very high acidity, then pasteurization can very well serve the purpose. But if you have very low acidity, then you need to go for commercial sterilization.
One question is, we always feel that the frozen foods are healthy. Why do we call it so?
Yeah.
And what are the main objectives that they offer?
Freezing, you know, is becoming a very good commercial technology, especially, you know, in cities, is an emerging technology in cities. And research has shown that frozen foods are healthy. Now, this has been elaborately covered in the chapter if you read. Now, they are called as healthy. Why? Because research has shown that frozen foods may have even higher nutrient, even higher than what you get from your fresh. This is basically because when the fruits and vegetables are harvested, they may take little time to reach you, say about 2 or 3 days. Mm-hmm. And during this period of transportation and reaching to the consumer, there can be, you know, loss of nutrients, especially, you know, vitamin C can suffer loss. But once the food is processed directly from the field, it goes to the processing unit. The time period is very less. it's even less than 24 hours. So in that case, the nutrient retention in the processed food, especially in the frozen food, is even higher than what you get from your market fresh. Because what you get in the freezing is field fresh, whereas what we get, the consumer gets, is market fresh. So there has been a lot of loss during transit. That is why, you know, frozen foods are said to be healthy, and they are becoming a very good source of important food, especially in cities, because of convenience. Now let's see, the question was, what are the advantages they offer? Now, because if you are freezing the tissues, you are freezing the cells, so naturally you are trying to reduce all the metabolic activities. All metabolic activities are controlled, and then because they are frozen, they offer hygienic foods. The color and the flavor and texture is preserved. Apart from this, you get very good convenience, because you get the 100% food which you want to eat. If you take a packet of peas, you need not shell peas. You get what 100% food which you want to cook, and then you can enjoy vegetables even off season.
What are the different kinds of fruits and vegetables that can be frozen?
Peas, of course, you have seen in market. Now, peas is a very common frozen product which we get in the market. Apart from then, you have other vegetables. Carrots can be frozen. Very good quality of carrots can be available during summers if you want. Cauliflower, broccoli and peppers, beans, okra. These are vegetables which can be very easily frozen. And fruits also, of course, not very common, but you can also freeze fruits, apples, strawberries, melon and cherries. These can also be very easily frozen.
What are the major operations in freezing processes and other unit operations?
Yeah, freezing, you know, basically freezing itself, you know, is a preservation method. We need not use any other kind of preservative in case of freezing, because we are keeping the temperature so low, even below 0°C. So freezing itself becomes a preservation method, and the basic operation is blanching. Always remember, the major purpose of blanching is to inactivate enzymes. So you are inactivating enzymes which can affect your color, which can affect the texture, and then you are, after blanching, you immediately freeze your material. So let's see some common unit operations. Just see, of course, the right kind of raw material. Specific, it's very important to select the right kind of cultivar which you are, variety. So if you want to freeze peas, then you should have a particular kind of variety which is suitable for freezing. After harvesting and transportation, you come to the preparative operations, cleaning, washing and slicing or whatever, dicing, and then blanching. Blanching is very and the major operation. Then again freezing at low temperature, and finally, you know, then it comes to storage. So blanching and then subsequent storage at cold, at very low temperature, -18°C. You always remember a very important thing, that after freezing, it's very important to maintain the quality, to store them at low temperatures, very -18 or even -30 to some cases. But commercially it is, say, -18 to -20°C.
Could you please throw some light on the main methods of freezing? For example, slow, quick method, etc.
Yeah, a sufficient part of in the chapter has been spent upon the freezing methods. We talk about slow freezing and quick freezing. Let us see what happens, you know, to the tissues when the tissues are slow freezing. When the product is frozen, there is an ice formation. In case of slow freezing, the ice crystals are very big. And subsequent to thawing is when you return your frozen material to room temperature. So when the ice crystals are very big, they damage the cell structure, and you get a very sloggy type of material. On contrast, when you do a quick freezing, because the crystals are very small, the texture of the food is maintained. So quick freezing is a commercial method which is followed in all kinds of freezing methods. The most important methods which we have discussed are air blast freezing and then fluidized bed freezing. In case of air blast freezing, what is done is that you there's a horizontal belt, and in which the frozen material the material moves, and it is frozen with the help of cold air. And the latest latest technology is fluidized bed freezing, which is usually used for particulate items like for cut beans or for cut peas. For particulate items, you know, there is a tendency when they freeze, there is a tendency for them to agglomerate together. They, you know, they form lumps. So in case of fluidized bed freezing, because of the cold air which is passed through perforations, they move very rapidly and there is little tendency for them to come closer. So this agglomeration is not possible. Then IQF technology is a commercial technology, if you see, which is being used for commercial freezers. If you have seen the Suffle peas, the Suffle peas, you know, is a IQF frozen, because again this kind of technology is suitable for particulate items like for peas, small size peas, and then beans. Even for strawberry it is being used, and the major advantage in this is that there is no particle agglomeration. They're not clumped together. So that is why if you have a half a kg packet of peas, and if you want to remove little quantity, you can very easily remove them because they are not clumped together. So they offer more convenience. So this is the latest IQF, that is individually quick frozen. That is why it is said individually quick frozen. Before I finish about freezing, let me also tell you that frozen fruits and vegetables have a very good life, shelf life. Say about 15 to 18 months is a normal shelf life, provided the temperatures are maintained. See, certain commodities, now if you take the example of strawberries, now if strawberries are frozen and if you thaw them, you see the resultant thawed material is very soft and mushy. This is basically, however best we try, it is difficult to maintain the character of fresh like characters of a fresh strawberry. That is why, you know, biotechnology tools are being used to incorporate certain proteins. Of, you know, proteins are being taken out from fish. Now there are certain kinds of fish which can survive at very low temperatures, minus temperatures, and there are even certain kind of plants which can survive very low temperatures. So scientists are trying to extract those proteins, anti-freeze proteins, and try to incorporate them into, say, even strawberry, so that they can maintain that fresh-like character even subsequent to freezing. So that is why I made a passing reference to the latest approach like anti-freeze protein. So it is something new for the students to know that this can be an upcoming technological improvement. If scientists can incorporate those anti-freeze proteins, then probably we can very much improve the quality of our frozen foods.
The next method of preservation is probably the most commonly accepted in olden times. Our mothers have been using this method of drying and dehydration. Yes. So in this, I would like to ask you, how do we do drying, and what are the primary pre-treatments that are undertaken for drying?
Yeah, drying, of course, it's a very common method, and let's see how drying occurs. Basically, the main principle behind drying is to remove moisture from the food. So we have said, you know, in the first part, because foods and commodity have very high amount of moisture. So if you can remove this moisture, we can control the spoilage. So naturally, if the moisture is removed, bacteria and yeast and mold spoilage will not be able to occur. And another important thing is that you have to know what is the optimum temperature. We cannot use a very high treatment like pasteurization or blanching, because if we use that kind of heat, then cooking will occur. So it is very important that optimum temperature with airflow, optimum airflow. So optimum temperature for drying is about 60 degrees C. So that is how drying occurs.
What are the kinds of vegetables and fruits that can be dried?
There's a list of vegetables and fruits You can dry potato, carrots, chili, any vegetable you take in, it's very easy to dry them. Normally these vegetables, ginger, peas, cauliflower, bitter gourd, tomato, even onions and garlic. And very commonly dried fruits are apple rings, apricots, peaches and papaya.
Are there any kinds of dryers that are used for drying them?
Yes, we have different kinds of dryers, and they have been sufficiently discussed in this unit. We have cabinet dryers, tunnel belt dryers, fluidized bed dryers and vacuum dryers. Different kinds of dryers have been discussed.
How would we determine that a particular fruit or vegetable has actually dried up?
It's always important to remember that when you dry a particular vegetable at a particular, always see that when it gets dried, automatically if you see from the visual observation, it turns to be brittle and crisp. And otherwise, if you see, for normal, it is recommended that a vegetable after drying, it should have about 10% or 7 to 10% moisture. In case of fruits, the moisture content may be slightly higher. So if you measure the moisture content, automatically you will come to know. And if the moisture content remains constant over a period of time, you come to know that complete drying has occurred. So you can even make it out by visual observation, and for more accurate, you can measure the moisture content.
Could we now go to the last topic of additives? Yeah. If you could throw some light on what are additives and their different types.
In this chapter, we have seen different methods of processing. We have seen freezing and dehydration. We have seen minimal processing. And then in between, we have also seen that certain kind of anti-browning agents or some preservatives have to be used. So basically, the additives which we use here in processing are basically a kind of additives. Now, let us see what is the definition of additive. It's a substance or a mixture other than your basic food, which is in the present in your food and which may be incorporated during production or during processing and during storage and packaging. But this will not include any of your chance contaminants. If you see any packet of a processed food, you find that sometimes it is written class 1 preservatives and class 2 preservatives. So for the students, it's very important to know what is the difference between these two kinds of class 1 and class 2. Basically, class 1 includes the common salt, sugar, spices, vinegar, and class 2 are basically your preservatives like sodium benzoate, which we use in tomato sauce, or potassium metabisulfite, which may be used in your beverages and squashes. So this is just a representation of class 1 preservatives. Their functions, of course, if you have read, they will improve the shelf life, enhance stability, also improve color. Always remember in this chapter that the difference between the preservatives KMS and sodium benzoate, what kind of preservative, for what kind of products you have to use potassium metabisulfite, and for what kind you have to use sodium benzoate. For if your product is a grape juice or a colored with anthocyanin, we use sodium benzoate. But if it is a mango juice or a lime juice, you can use potassium metabisulfite. Because if you use potassium metabisulfite in a colored product, say of grape, this will bleach off the color. So students should focus on this part, the kind of product and the kind of preservative you are going to use. And then
lastly, if you could quickly explain the function of different types of additives. We are running out of time, I think.
Basic functions, if you see, just important ones, preservative we have seen. Then sometimes even they may be used as coloring agents in squashes and in beverages. Colors, but all permitted colors may be added. Some natural colors, even acidulants. Because when we use citric acid, this is a common acidulant. They may be used as antioxidants to prevent rancidity in oils, normally used in oils, vitamin E is added. Also flavors in ice creams, you see even colors are added, vanilla flavor and chocolate flavor, orange flavor. So these are all kinds of additives.
So thank you, Dr. Charanjit Kaur, for a very illustrious question answer session. Thank you so much.